In this episode, I'm going to talk about the rheology of the melt in powder bed fusion. We really haven't talked much about the flowing behavior, mostly about the thermal properties of the material. And the flow behavior or rheology is really the science of deformation and flow. And for polymers, we have two different types of rheometers that we can use depending on the process we're working with. So a lot of times in conventional polymer processing, we have very high shear rates and we use capillary rheometers to assess that behavior. In material extrusion, for example, that's also an important measurement. However, in powder bed fusion, we really have no flow. We don't really have a shear rate on our material. It's just the laser that hits it, and we're looking at the coalescence of the powder. And for that, the molecular mobility is important. So I have here a schematic that shows different types of rheometers that can be used. And in plastics, we use the rotational rheometer and capillary rheometer. But if we have no flow or not really a deformation on the material, low deformation, like we have with the powder coalescence, then a rotational rheometer is the most interesting, because also looking at low time scales where we want to study the molecular motion and entanglement that can happen. Disentanglement for the flow to happen, and entanglement is something that we would really like to achieve across the layer boundaries. So we're focusing on the rotational rheometer, but I still wanted to show you how a typical flow curve looks that we can generate by using the two types of rheometers. So that's really what you want to characterize a polymer for, where you use a rotational rheometer like our Kinexus to study the viscosity at low shear rates. And then eventually as the shear rates get high and get into the injection molding or extrusion shear rate level, then we want to use a capillary. And you see how the two methods really work together and give us a big picture of the flow behavior. Again, we're focusing on this here and the Kinexus rheometers now. That's powder bed fusion. So how does the rotational rheometer like a Kinexus work? We have heard of something similar before when I talked about the dynamic mechanical analysis, DMA. That is also the study stress and strain, but for and the viscoelastic properties, but for solids. Now we're doing a very similar analysis, but on a melt, and for that we need a different device, but a melt needs to be contained in a different way and so on. So the quantities that are important here are also the shear stress, so the force or the pressure per area, and the resulting shear strain, so the displacement divided by the height, and that is actually shown here. So the force would be, we have two plates, two parallel plates. We have our sample in between, and we're displacing the upper plate by moving it. And in reality, we're actually rotating it. And we use a certain force to get a displacement of the distance u over the height of the sample. And then the shear rate or strain rate is the change in strain with time. So we have this sample sandwiched between the two plates, experience a strain or shear rate, depending on the type of stress we apply. And we get a shear profile over that thickness of the sample. And from that, we can calculate the material properties that we're most interested in. And that is the viscosity, that's shear stress over shear rate, tau over gamma dot, and the modulus, not the elastic modulus, but the shear modulus, G, is shear stress over shear strain. And those are the important properties that we want to investigate. The viscosity we get when we do a rotational rheometer, so viscometry where the upper plate rotates continuously. And then we also have that case where the upper plate moves back and forth. We have an oscillation, and that gives us the viscoelasticity. And you remember when we talked about the DMA, we had that deformation of in three-point bending going up and down. It's really that oscillation that gives us the elastic and the storage and loss component that we're looking for. Which effects can we study with that? On a polymer sample, we can get the viscosity, the zero shear viscosity, where we don't have an effect on of shear rate, and we also get the shear thinning and thickening. That is something for material extrusion, for example. We also get the glass transition, viscoelastic behavior, elastic recovery, yield stress. But we could potentially get the deformation during the coating process. We can study the molecular weight distribution. For example, the degradation effects. I mentioned the polycondensation that happens for a nylon 12. Rheology is another way to study that. We could study the relaxation time, and that is very important for the bonding or welding that we get between layers, not only for powder bed fusion. That's something that is relevant in almost all of the layered processes. And we can get the gel point, another quantity that's important if we're dealing with thermosets that cure. So the gel point tells us something about the cure time and temperature. And as we're talking mostly about UV curable resins, a rheometer can be coupled with a UV light source to actually obtain these values. But now we're going back to powder bed fusion. For powder bed fusion, our viscosity requirements are different than they are for other processes, because we have no deformation acting on the powder particles, as I mentioned earlier. So the coalescence that we get really depends on this zero shear viscosity that we get without the effect of shearing, and the molecular weight. So how long are the chains? The longer the chains, the higher the viscosity, the worse the flow behavior and surface tension. So for powder bed fusion, the viscosity should be low, and we can use rheology to study that effect as a function of temperature or between materials, so we can see which material is more suitable for the process. The molecular weight should be not too high and not too low. So we want it on the lower side, so the viscosity is low, but we don't want the molecular chains to be too short, otherwise the mechanical properties of our final part are low. So we need a balance there. But we also want that molecular weight to not change or change as little as possible over the long periods of time at elevated temperatures. And we want to understand that, obviously. So now let's first look at the zero shear viscosity. So what's our viscosity behavior of a material? So I show here a schematic of the viscosity as a function of shear rate. We've seen the measurement curve before. That's measured in rotation. So upper plate constantly rotates. And we see that at low shear rates, the viscosity is independent of the shear rate, and we call that the zero shear viscosity eta naught. And then as soon as we reach a certain level of shear rate, and that's depending on the material itself and its molecular structure, then we see a shear thinning effect. So that's what happens typically for any polymer material. And when we look now at the behavior of our nylon 12, we see that we have that typical zero shear plateau and then shear rate dependence. It's not really interesting for us because we don't reach these shear rates, but it's also something that we see at very low shear rates, that the viscosity is slightly higher, and that is related to the continuing polycondensation that also happens during such a measurement. So that is the polycondensation is responsible for this little increase if we go in this direction as we're going to lower shear rates. So zero shear viscosity, that's important to understand how a certain material behaves at the temperature where it's melted and how it compares to other materials. And then when we want to look at crystallization behavior and modulus change, we go to the measurement in oscillation. So there we look at viscoelasticity, storage, modulus loss, modulus damping factor. Check that out in the DMA video if you want a refresher. So here I brought two examples, and actually, sorry, I didn't have time to measure these, so I took them out of textbooks and publications. The first I want to show is the complex viscosity. So if we measure in oscillation rather than in rotation, we get that real and imaginary part of the viscosity, and we can look at the complex viscosity, similar as we look to the zero shear viscosity. And what's plotted here is this complex viscosity in blue, but also the gap, so the distance between the plates that that we have in the measurement. And that is relevant because it also gives us an idea of shrinkage that, for example, could happen due to crystallization. So in this measurement, we used there were three different frequencies used. I'm just showing this schematically. With increasing frequency, the complex viscosity is lower, so faster deformation. Not super relevant for us, just in general, as we're performing the measurement over time, the viscosity increases and the gap decreases. That's the green line. And that's because crystallization happens over time. We looked previously at the isothermal crystallization behavior in a differential scanning colorimetry, and we saw that crystallization is a time-dependent process, and that's exactly the effect we see here. But here we see it, its effect on the flow behavior of the material. So the longer we wait, more resistance to flow we actually get, so the coalescence would get worse and worse. But obviously that happens on very fast time scales. So time in minute is what's happening to layers further down. That's not really happening to the top layer. But it's important if we want to understand the bonding between layers, if that can happen over time as we're building up layer by layer. So that's an important quantity, really, to understand your material better and how you can improve properties and things like that. And then on the right, I show an oscillation measurement where we actually look at the storage and the loss modulus. What is changed here is the temperature, and we look at over time. So we start from a high temperature and we're seeing cooling effect, and then we keep that temperature constant. And as the material is cooling, the storage and loss modulus are increasing. So the flexibility of the material is starting to decrease because of lower temperature. But as the temperature stays constant over time, we still see an increase in the two moduli. And what we see at a certain point, we have this crossover between storage and loss modulus. And that is very interesting because in this range here, the storage modulus, so the elastic response, is lower than the viscous response, the loss modulus. And that's characteristic of a liquid. So That means we're in the melt state here. But then over time, we see that the storage modulus overcomes the loss modulus, and that really tells us this is where the solidification, crystallization happens. So it's another interesting way to study the crystallization behavior, two different ways, and especially the one on the right couples the crystallization behavior also with the mechanical response and the modulus, and that is interesting as we're looking at warpage and all of those things, that we can really see the transition from the melt to the solid. And that's why rheology is so interesting. It can tell us something about the viscosity, potential porosity that we get with that, and the behavior that we see as new material is being deposited. How does the material warp? How does it deform? So that rounds up the different aspects of material science and powder bed fusion. There's a lot more mechanical properties and so on, but this is what we can cover now, and we'll move on to other additive manufacturing technologies in the next episodes.